dying Christ destroyed our death. Rising Christ restored our life. Christ will come again in glory, as in baptism, Eleanor, Elizabeth, Hughes put on Christ, and so in Christ may Eleanor be clothed with glory. Here and now, dear friends, we're God's children. What we shall be has not yet been revealed, but we know when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Those who have this hope purify themselves as Christ is pure. Jesus said, I'm the resurrection, I am the life, and those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I'm the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I'm alive forevermore. And I hold the keys of hell and death, and because I live, you shall live also. Friends, we're gathered here to praise God and to witness our faith and celebrate Eleanor's life. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. May God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow, hope, and in death, resurrection. If you'd please stand, and we're going to sing our opening hymn, number 364, Because He Lives.
Thank you.
welcome you to Ebenezer United Methodist Church and say a particular or specific greeting for Eleanor's daughters, who were such a reflection of her and what she handed off to them. You could see a physical resemblance when you look at those photos, but much more so when you spend time with them, you see a deeper resemblance. And for the numerous grandchildren and great-grandchildren and just the legacy that she leaves behind, and we're just very humbled to have you all here. And it was her desire that this would be a celebration. If anybody has a problem with that, they can leave now. Because indeed, while we do mourn this loss, but we celebrate victory and the rest that she has earned. Let us pray. Oh, eternal God, we praise you for the great company of all those who have finished their course in faith and now rest from their labor. We praise you for those who are dear to us, whom we name in our hearts before you, and especially we give you thanks and praise you for Eleanor, whom you've graciously received in your presence. To all of these, grant your peace. Let perpetual light shine upon them, and help us, Lord, to believe what we have not seen, that your presence may lead us through our years and bring us at last return with her again to the joy of your home, a home not made with human hands but eternal in the heavens, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I'm going to read a passage from the great prophet Isaiah, chapter 40. He writes, "Comfort, O comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God, that every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all the people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken." The voice says, "Cry out," and I say, "What shall I cry?" All the people are grass, their constancy is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades, when the breath of the Lord blows upon it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is an everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. And even youth will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and will not faint. Now the 23rd Psalm, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
One of the songs that Eleanor or Nana wanted sung at her funeral, not only one of the songs, but the song she wanted sung at her funeral, was "In the Garden." And so we'll do that today. Oh, voice I hear falling on my ear. The Son of God discloses, and He walks with me, and He talks with me, and He tells me I am His own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. He speaks at the sound of His voice, it is so sweet the birds hush their singing, and the melody that He gave to me within my heart is ringing. And He walks with me, and He talks with me, and He tells me I am His own. And the joy we share as we tarry,
to our entire family. So I'm John Pilger. This is my sister Diane Hollander. And so my grandmother, affectionately known as Nana, I didn't know she had a name other than Nana for most of my life. So today we're here to celebrate her life. And we spent some time as a family on Saturday last night, sharing stories and talking about so many things that meant so much to us and the impact that she had on our lives. And we went for hours, and we picked out pictures, and it was just so comforting for us to think about Nana and the life that she shared and the impact that we have on each of us today. So today we have four generations, and so Nana has three children, and my mom, Joni, as she called her, and Diane, Aunt Diane, and then Clinton are here. So three at that generation, 13 of the grandchildren, 15 great-grandchildren, and three great-great-grandchildren, one of which is here today. So there was a period of time we had five generations, and that's just such a testament to her and what she was really all about, because family was so important to her. And again, we're just so blessed today to celebrate her life. So she was born in 1915. And in 1920, women were allowed to vote. So if you think about the life that she's had, she lived through the Great Depression, 17 presidents, two world wars, civil rights. I had also included women's rights, but I was quickly corrected that that's still in progress. So don't claim victory on that one just yet. But so many changes that she was witnessed and a part of in her lifetime. She retired in 1962 from Boeing and McDonnell Douglas to help raise her children. Her life just spanned so many years, 101 years, across so many historic events. So Nana was special to all of us, and in so many ways, and I see her in so many of us in so many different ways. But she'd always start off with a very polite, subtle way to make her point.
Right.
And if you caught on to that, then then things were okay. If you didn't, then it became a little more direct. And then if you didn't get that, you know, it was even worse. So, but we, you know, as we sat and talked and shared stories, she wanted to make sure that we understood what her life was all about, the struggles and all the things that she accomplished in her life and how important that is to us. And how important it is for us to be a family and be committed as a family. And she would talk about family in the sense of, and I think Elisa shared this story with us, don't use the best china when your guest or your company, or maybe Daniel shared it. Your best china is very appropriate to use with your family, because your family is special. And it's not just the guests that show up for dinner. She generally cared about friends through church, through United Methodist Women, through many things that she did, support for so many groups and friends. And she cared so much about her family, but in particular, and I'll say this with all the guys present, the women, right? She had that special bond with them. She was the leader of the family for 100 years or 101 years as in her life, but 81 years as she had children and they began to have children, and she led by example, and that's just few and far between today, but that's really how she thought about herself and what she wanted to pass along to her family. And she wanted each of us to be proud of who we are, what we've accomplished, and to be the best that we could be and be proud of that. And so Diane's going to share a couple of the stories that that we share.
Right. Well, as we were talking last night, we did kind of begin to notice that the girls seemed to get a little bit of a different perspective on Nana, because Nana wanted, you know, Miss Emily Post, she wanted to make sure that we kind of knew the things that we needed to be doing and that kind of thing. So it was kind of a different, I think, relationship between us. But she had a younger sister, Isabel, and Linda, my cousin Linda's here. Isabel was 3 years and 3 months younger. And if you ever said, well, how much age difference is there between you and your sister? She would never say 3 years. It was always 3 years and 3 months. At any rate, we were so honored when Linda came. She brought Annie Bell's, as we always knew her as Annie Bell, brought Annie Bell's ashes. And so Annie Bell is tucked in nice and tight with her sister. Nana, we were never sure whether Nana was in charge of watching Annie Bell or Annie Bell was in charge of watching Nana. But together, you know, they had a very, very special bond. And so when they were growing up in New York, This actually was a time when Nana was supposed to be watching her sister. And instead, I think Isabel was watching her as she would. Nana said, I remember one time I was sitting with Nana when she was at Mom's, and I said to her, I said, well, Nana, what'd you guys do? You were in New York, you know, these two girls by themselves, whatever. She one time said to me, she said, I'd do anything the boys could do. She said, you'd get on your roller skates, you'd get on the back of a cab, and she said, man, it was great. She would ride down the streets of New York behind a cab, and I said, well, where was Isabel? She said, I told her to stand on the corner and wait for me. And so, yeah, mm-hmm. And so that one, and then she would tell me about jumping on trains which I thought, wow, I don't know if that sounds too safe. But, yeah, so Nana would talk about, you know, the guys, the boys used to like to run and jump on the trains. She'd jump on the trains, jump off the trains, whatever. And I guess all that kind of ended when the police, I think it was about the third time they took her back home, that they told my great-grandmother this was going to stop. So she was a bit of an adventuresome sort of person, and she carried that through her life. She was a little bit fearless. But so she spent 41 years on the East Coast, 38 on the West Coast, and then after she had, she retired and helped, you know, raise my cousins. We were older, but we were all having babies. So she decides she's coming back this direction. And so at 78, and you know, my grandfather was blind, so at 78 she drove across from Sacramento because I was having my first, I was having Caitlin. And so she drove across, and that was the year we got this massive snowstorm over there. And so she, I remember, and this was before, you know, nobody had a cell phone, that kind of stuff. And so she came in, and she was like white-knuckled and, you know, that kind of thing. And I said, Nana, I thought maybe you would stop. She said, hon, if I had stopped, I'd have never made it here. We got 17 inches of snow. She got in before it started, and that's because she just didn't stop, and that was Nana. Well, hon, I thought you'd need me. I just had to keep going. And she moved here the year Christy was born, in 93, the year Christy was born, because she figured we all needed some help, and that was Nana. She just wanted to be where she could help us. And so she moved here, and she lived in Roswell with Sue pretty independently for quite a while, and then she moved out with mom and dad. And you know, for Nana, it was never about what you could do for her. It was, she would always want to know what she could do for you. And you know, to the point where up until the last 2 or 3 weeks, if you went in and she's basically in a bed, she really, you know, she can't ambulate, she can't, you know. And we were feeding her, and you would say, hey, Nana, how you feeling? There'd be, I'm just great. I'm fine. And but that was her. She never wanted anyone to focus on her as much as she wanted to focus on what can I do to help you. And so I think it's a wonderful legacy that she has left. And since I've got the New Testament reading, I mean, that just worked out well, huh, John? Yeah, I'm already up here. So I'll just go ahead and read. These are just some selected readings from 1 Corinthians 15. Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaim to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved. Now, if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection of the dead? For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised. If Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile and you are still in your sins. Then those of you who have died in Christ have perished. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have died. But someone will ask, how are the dead raised? With what kind of body do they come? Fool, what you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And as for what you sow, you do not sow the body that is to be, but a bare seed, perhaps of wheat or some other grain. But God gives it a body as he has chosen. What is sown is perishable, what is raised is imperishable. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown in a physical body, it is raised in a spiritual body. When this perishable body puts on imperishability, and this mortal body puts on immortality, and then the saying that is written will be fulfilled. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Sitting here trying to figure out how much more proud Nana could possibly be of her family. And when Mike might compete with that would be Jack. I'm sure they're probably discussing now who's had a greater influence in some of these, but I know they're all delighted, indeed, as we all are. Now, I would say that say in service like this, it's bittersweet, but it's really not. It's sweet. It really is. With that in mind, I'm gonna have a little reading here from the Gospel of John, some select readings from the 14th chapter. The words of Jesus says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I'm going. I will not leave you orphaned. I'm coming to you. In a little while, the world will see me no longer, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. I've said these things to you while I'm still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you all that I've said to you. Peace I leave you. My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." This is the good news of the gospel. This is the truth. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
It can sometimes be very challenging and difficult to memorialize somebody. And sometimes, you know, to try to be fair and accurate and honor that person, you've got to dig a little bit. And this is the opposite case. There's this is not in any way a challenge or struggle. This is really a privilege to talk about Nana and this family. And so last night when I happened to be by the house, and there were, you know, at some point 15, 17, 19, 20 just milling around the house in various rooms. You know, so unusual in this day and age. I was trying to be observant, kind of peeking around. And this lively conversation, everything was taking place. I didn't see anybody staring down at a cell phone. I didn't see anybody who seemed bored. And while the family was talking about their stories that were sharing, it wasn't a struggle, it was with great enthusiasm. I was enjoying it because Nana clearly was one of a kind. I heard many wonderful things, some things I would not share. Well, you know, it that's what caused me there. In some ways, now I'm going to change some of the things that I talk about in premarriage counseling. I think I'm smarter because of it. And part of that is, when I talk to couples about to get married, I always say, you know, the two become one, it's a new team, and you're the new team, and you leave the old team behind for this reason. You know, man leave his mother and father, and two become one. And I always say, you know, you got to protect each other. And that means when one of the in-laws comes over, somebody else says, you know, you have to protect your spouse, because whether it's mom or mother-in-law, whoever comes over, and they want to do things better than you, it's like, you know, that can be very offensive to the woman, right? Well, I'm changing all this now because I know better. Because what I've learned about Nana is this. She comes in and she does this right here. She goes, "Oh, dear. I know you didn't have time. You're a busy person." But what's so awesome about this, and it really is awesome, and that is, let me explain something. The key in our walk in our faith, our relationship with the Lord, which is a model of marriage and our family relationship, the key is always, it's obedience. That's a word that we cringe from, obedience. And the reason we cringe from it is because we're rebellious. I thought, are you being obedient? I said, dogs are obedient, right? But that's the goal. See, the law can never bring about obedience because we rebelled against the law. Obedience can only really happen in freedom and in love. And most of the family, and the things that Nana did, is coming, it's really, it's some great stories, is that when she came into a home, and they said they would clean up and prepare for her arrival. Now, it was clearly different for the women than the men. I'm sure the men got so, that's probably why Jack had such a big shop out there. Right? That's probably why Jack always had projects. See, now I'm starting to get the picture. I got to go build a new room somewhere. Where? Anywhere. Right? See, but for the, you know, for the women were clear for Nana, and they knew it was going to happen to come over, and I guess clear out everything in the refrigerator. I love to hear this. And it's like, so how long this been in there? But here's the thing, where most of us, see, we would get really offended by this. But you know why they didn't? You know why? Because it was love. It was relationship. And because they knew that what she was doing was wanting them to be the best they could do. They knew there was never a question what her motive was. It's always about the heart. It's always about the heart. The rest of it's just stuff. And so if you love somebody unconditionally, you get to come in and point out, hey, we got a problem here. It's been here too long. And so that's the joy in that. And so through all the sharing and the family, what an astonishing family. Look at the number, 5 generations and now 4. And so through all that sharing, never a note of frustration, never a note of bitterness. But you know what the desire was? To be obedient. And his obedience, it was out of love and not even understanding, because it really sounds to me that Nana lived to a higher level than the rest of us. You know, come in and not only look at the kitchen cabinet and refrigerator, but it's like, I got to show you how to clean the bathroom. Take notes. Isn't that great? I've never heard of this before. Stand there and watch. I'm going to show you how to... That's discipleship. It is. You know what teaching isn't? Teaching isn't this. That's just blather. Teaching a disciple is, you wait right there. I'm going to show you. You know why I'm going to show you? Because it matters. It matters. And it mattered to her enough to teach them so they could teach the next generation. And it set a standard. But a standard is cleanliness and order, all that. But the greater standard is love. The goal is obedience. We will never be obedient by the law. We'll only be obedient through love and relationship and respect and knowing that somebody loves us so much they're going to show us how to do things right and model it for us. Jesus did the exact same thing. I can't really think of a better legacy than that. And it really is. While it's sad in a way and a struggle, it is such an honor and a privilege. So thank you to all of you. Y'all are a wonderful representation and a reflection of the people that have loved you. Let us pray. Lord, we give you thanks for the life of Eleanor, for a life well lived, for a model of discipleship, for somebody who so dearly loves her family that she is willing to get on her hands and knees and show them how to do things the right way. And Lord, I thank you for a family who loved her enough to listen and accept and learn. And for all these things, Lord, for all these things, we laugh and tear up and celebrate. And for that, we give you thanks. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now I ask you to stand and we're going to sing. 378, one of her favorites. It's probably even a bigger favorite now. Amazing Grace.
Thank you.